Southern Iowa, it's a good day just to very simply be together to worship the Lord and want to encourage you to do that just with all your heart today. Glad that you are here amidst all the current situations. Glad you're here to just trust in the Lord with all your heart. Want to share with you a couple of things. Launch date is today for Operation Christmas Child. Everybody's been bringing shoeboxes in. It's good to see good to see you supporting that, and it will make a difference in the life of some kids around the world to get a chance to know they're loved and also to hear the gospel as well. So we're excited for that. Remember our Thanksgiving Eve service. We did this morning just because of the current situation. We did put off our harvest dinner. That may come, you know, may come somewhere down the road a little bit if things clear out a little bit. We still love to get together and as a church fellowship. And one of the best things we do together is eat, right? So we will get that going on. It doesn't have to happen just around Thanksgiving. But remember our Thanksgiving Eve service. It'll be at 7 p.m. on Wednesday night, this coming Wednesday. We've encouraged our Sunday school classes to all participate. So even, you know, we'd love to have high school on up. We realize that we probably couldn't handle what the junior hires lay down on us, we'd encourage you to participate in some way. So and I wanted just to say, you know, we didn't plan the way this would all work out. We didn't plan for Sunday school today, but if Sunday school classes, if you'd like to meet for a little bit afterwards and you need to get together and discuss some of your plans for Wednesday night, I would encourage you to do so. I know Danny even has a little bit of a lesson for you. So if you want to come down to the basement, we'll include you in our Sunday school class that way as well. So, but remember Thanksgiving Eve service at 7 p.m. on Wednesday night. And then next Sunday, come together. It's going to be a special Sunday. Our youth are going to be leading our worship service that Sunday. And you'll be excited. They're going to be sharing. We've been on the Wells and Wilderness campaign as we travel through the Bible. They're going to put a caveat in the middle of that, put a little nugget in the middle of that. Is that a better one? A little nugget in the middle of that. And talking about the kingdom of God. So you guys all ready up there to make it happen next Sunday? pretty excited, I can tell. So we are too. So anyways, we're looking forward to you guys sharing with us about the kingdom of God and how that fits into wells and wildernesses. I think there's a really neat message for you in there. So come and be aware of that. Instead of decking the halls, we're going to deck the sanctuary this year, and we're going to be doing that December 7th at 7 p.m. So we're calling, if you like to come and decorate for Christmas, be here that night. It happens to be the night that our elders and deacons meet, and so that leaves me out. I'm really sorry about that, but I won't be decorating the sanctuary this year, like I do every year. We'll be helpful by staying out of the way, and it'll look a lot nicer when it's done. So, but anyways, we do want to encourage anybody who'd like to help out that way. Pardon me? Okay. Cookies and eggnog. All right. If there happens to be a pie, I'm missing board meeting, okay? So anyway, so help out with that. Our Christmas children's program is set up for December the 20th. That's the week ahead. And I want to encourage parents to get involved. We're going to do kind of something creative this year that Connie's come up with. We're going to hear from families this Christmas as part of our Christmas children program. And so she sent out some correspondence to the parents, and she needs to hear back from you. We're going to celebrate the birth of Jesus in a special way, and we're looking for some special help. So if you have children or grandchildren and would like to get and plugged into that special service that day, we're going to be just singing a lot of Christmas carols and Christmas songs that day, and singing about the birth of Christ and being shared with from that perspective. So we look forward to that. Be involved in that. So lots of other things that are going on right now in life. Make sure and reach out to others. Some of you have taken up the challenge to sponsor some of our shut-ins for Thanksgiving time. And if you want to reach out to them, and we appreciate many of you reaching out to them in some special ways around Thanksgiving as well. Glad you're here. Eddie's going to come and share a little sermon bumper with you this morning. Just a few prayer requests as he comes. Do be remembering the family of Beverly Miller. This is Vanita Escher's cousin. Sonia Scadden, continue to lift her up as she goes through treatments. And Jerry and Alice Brown, making a lot of decisions as far as their health concerns are going. Joe had some good news on his legs. He's switching some medication, and situation there is improving greatly. Do keep Greg Cleghorn in your prayers as he begins a series of treatments for tonsil cancer. He's already gone through the tonsillectomy, and he's currently talking with doctors about the route of treatment he's taking. So keep those folks in your prayers. Thank you. Let's also remember Ben Bemis in your prayers. Ben has contracted COVID, and he's actually been moved up to Methodist Hospital in Des Moines, and pretty serious condition for Ben, so keep him in your prayers if you would. Thank you, Cindy. Any others? Yes. Okay. Yes, Jerry Brown has been transferred down to a nursing facility in Leon, Iowa. So do keep Alice in your prayers that way, as there's a lot of transitions coming up for both of them. So keep them in your prayers. Any others this morning? Sorry. Yes. Got that here. Eric Foland. We learned last week that his cancer was back. So keep him in your prayers as well. So thank you. Remember Kurt Jeter continuing to go through treatments for cancer as well. And I heard that's going pretty good. But do keep him in your prayers that way. Yes. Oh, good. Yeah. So pray for Peyton Flaherty. He's traveling home for Thanksgiving, been serving our country. So we're proud of that boy, or young man. Yes. And Krista Schweery, keep her in your prayers. She's kind of had a flare-up of her MS, and it's affecting her eyes and her vision and her blood pressure issues. So keep Krista in your prayers as well, would you? Okay. I think we got her covered. Let's focus on God's Word.
So one quick thing on the If you want to uplift somebody this Thanksgiving or this this holiday season, there is a list here with some names that have not got somebody to take care of that family. See Vicky, or try to find this piece of paper somewhere. Put your name down there if you want an idea of who to lift up or who needs somebody to lift them up. We have a list here for you. Lists usually just make everything easier. Have you ever gotten advice from somebody older than you? Yes, we've all gotten advice from somebody that's older than us. Usually about the choices you're going to make, the decisions you're going to make. Do we listen? No, not usually. And then what do we realize later? That we should have listened. They were right. And why were they right? Because they've been there. They've done that. They've messed up before. Seems like the longest and hardest class or lesson that each of us takes is the one on decision making. It takes us years and years to start to understand one concept about decisions, about the choices that we make. And that is that the choices we make matter. And they not only matter to me, but they matter and they affect those around me. So we've been making our way through the scriptures, stopping at some wells, going through some wildernesses along the way. We've been in the Old Testament, and I really appreciate all of scripture. There's a lot of history there. I mean, it's an old book, and this book has stood the test of time, inspired by God, tried and true, and has a lot to say about the choices that we make. From beginning to end, the biggest choice, the biggest decision, the biggest lesson, one of the most reoccurring themes is who you choose to serve. Who will you live for? We look at Israel. What a roller coaster, right? Following God, not following God. Following God, turning away from God. You can read all over the results of both of those decisions, following God and not following God. But it really boils down to, who will you serve? Which way will you go? There are no shortcuts. Have you ever heard that speech from somebody older than you? There are no shortcuts in life. There are no shortcuts. There's only one way. The way, the truth, and the life. I'm going to go to John chapter 10 and read verses 1 through 18 this morning. Very truly I tell you, Pharisees, anyone who does not enter the sheep pen by the gate, but climbs in by some other way, is a thief and a robber. The one who enters by the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. The gatekeeper opens the gate for him, and the sheep listen to his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought out all his own, he goes on ahead of them, and his sheep follow him because they know his voice. But they will never follow a stranger. In fact, they will run away from him because they do not recognize a stranger's voice. Jesus used this figure of speech, but the Pharisees did not understand what he was telling them. Therefore, Jesus said again, "Very truly I tell you, I am the gate for the sheep. All who have come before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep have not listened to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved, and they will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal, kill, and destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it to the full. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for his sheep. The hired hand is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep. So when he sees the wolf coming, he abandons the sheep and runs away. The wolf attacks the flock and scatters it. The man runs away because he is a hired hand and cares nothing for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep, and my sheep know me. Just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that are not in this sheep pen. I must bring them also. They too will listen to my voice, and there shall be one flock and one shepherd. The reason my Father loves me is that I lay down my life, only to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down on my own accord. I have authority to lay it down and authority to take it up again. This command I received from my Father." Let's pray. Jesus, as we come before you today, we are truly thankful for the way that you sacrificed for us, Father, for what you've called us to and what you've called us out of. Lord, I pray that you be with us today, and I pray that you be with Brian as he gives us your message, Lord, that we could take it to heart, Lord, through your Spirit, just set a fire in your church, Father, and allow it to spread and leak out into our lives, Lord, so we can live for you. We can live to build your kingdom here on earth, here and now. So, Jesus, we thank you so much for who you are and all that you've done for us, Lord. We're so blessed. So we come before you today to say thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Oftentimes when we think of Thanksgiving, we think about stuffing our stomachs. But Thanksgiving is more a condition of the heart than it is a condition of a full stomach. And I hope your heart is full. How many of you have been working on your list of 100 things you're thankful for? You don't have to raise your hand, but I just wanted to remind you of that. I want you to work on those things, 100 things that you're thankful for. One of the things that God reminds us of that he wants more than anything is a thankful heart. Stand up with me. And this morning, I hope you can sing this song with truth. I hope you can sing it from your heart. I hope you can sing that he has made me glad, all right? Are you glad you know Jesus, the living water? Let's sing it out. Here we go. You can clap if you want to. I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. I will say this is the day that the Lord hath made. I will rejoice for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. Okay, now, sing it one time and smile so big that I can see it through your mask. Here we go. Here we go. All right. I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. I will say this is the day that the Lord has made. Cowboy hat. I will rejoice for he has made. This is a great song for a cowboy hat. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice for he has made me glad. I wish you could see what I see sometimes. I'm glad God has made you glad. I am glad this morning. Let's continue in worship and praise.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who sings so whole with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes me orphan, a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. is amazing grace.
Yes, you can be seated.
Because of that amazing grace, there's room at the cross for us. As we prepare for a time of communion, I just invite you to come and recognize that just as you are, Jesus invites you. Just as you are, Jesus loves you. But he longs for you as you participate in this to recognize the transformation that he wants to make in you. And there's room at the cross for you. Let's sing it.
The cross upon which Jesus died is a shelter in which we can hide. His grace is so free, it's sufficient for me, and is its fountain as wide as the sea. There's room at the cross for you. There's room at the cross for you. Though millions have come, there's still room for one. Yes, there's room at the cross.
Part
before it's too late, there's room at the cross for you. Yes, there's room at the cross for you. The millions have come, there's still room for one. Yes, there's room at the cross.
Play it one time as our communion man comes, okay? Sometimes, you know, in life things happen. Come on up here quick, Randy, save me from this. Sometimes things happen and things don't go perfectly. But you know what? That's what reminds us of our need for the cross, isn't it? That we don't got it all together. We don't know all the words. We don't know all the next lines or phrases to be spoken. But the one thing is for certain, there's room at the cross.
This letter to the Thessalonians. So this is the end of the Thessalonians, kind of the final deal here. And he says, "Now we ask you, brothers, to respect those who work hard among you, who are over you in the Lord, and who admonish you. Hold them in the highest regard and love because of their work. Live in peace with each other, and we urge you, brothers, warn those who are idle. Encourage the timid, help the weak, be patient with everyone. Make sure that nobody pays back wrong for wrong, but always try to be kind to each other and to everyone else. Be joyful always, pray continually, and give thanks in all circumstances, For this is the Lord's will for you in Jesus Christ. We pray. Dear Lord, we want to thank you for giving your son Jesus to us. And Jesus, we just want to thank you for everything that you've done for us. For you sacrificed your life on that cross for each one of us, just for the forgiveness of our sins, so that we have the opportunity to be with you in heaven. So as we take this communion, let's just give our thanks to Jesus for what he's done of us, because he's the only way that we could be in heaven with you someday. Thank you.
Last song she played in there was I Surrender All. I hope you're ready to surrender this morning as you turn open with me to the book of Jeremiah. If you're from my generation, will you finish this line? Jeremiah was a... Wow, you did that good. No, he was a prophet, you bunch of idiots. Boy, I've been waiting to call you that for a long... No, you're not. I apologize. Forgive me for that, but it was kind of fun. Jeremiah was a prophet, and he lived during the time of the split kingdom. All right, this is way back, right after Solomon and Rehoboam, and then they had this line: both sides, 20 kings, and there were only very few that maintained any godly integrity during this time. Jeremiah was a weeping prophet, where we learn from Scripture. And so as we walk through this passage of Scripture, you know, not only is there a lot of water alluded to, but it's a time of spiritual wilderness for Jeremiah and the people of Israel. And part of that is because of leadership, but most of it is because of, and I want you to hear this today, it's very important to understand, part of it was because of leadership, but most of it was because of individual choice. Do you know that God created you with a free will? And you have free will to decide, what'll it be? What'll it be? Where do you hear those words spoken in your life? Who says to you, what'll it be? A bartender. Thank you for being brave enough to spit that one out. Okay, a waitress or a bartender, you know? John and I would hang out on the boat, and several other of us would, Shane would hang out at the boat on Mondays, and Misty would wait on us, and she'd come up to the table and say, what'll it be? You know, and you've got choices in life that you have to make, and this is one of those scriptures that encourages you to make a choice. So I went in and did some more deep theological reading. You know what happens when I do deep theological reading. I turned to some of my favorite authors, and most of them are children's authors. And so I turned to Dr. Seuss for this one, as we're going to be looking at Jeremiah, the sixth chapter. And again, bear in mind the context of Jeremiah speaking to the people of Israel, literally heartbroken and weeping because they continually choose the wrong path. They continually make the wrong choice in life. And what happens, and why Jeremiah and why God weeps in that process, is because when we continually make the wrong choices, we choose to walk away from the abundant life that God has for us to live. Have you experienced that in life? When you live according to God's plan for your life, that life is much more joyful, much more peaceful, much more simple. Not always easy. We're going to address that, so don't attack me yet with your eyes. But not always easy, but it is much more joyful when we live according to God's word than we live according to our own will. So I want to read to you from a poem from Dr. Seuss, because that is often where I go in children's reading when I go for deep theology. And this poem is entitled The Zode. Have you ever heard, anybody ever heard the poem from Dr. Seuss, The Zode? Oh, okay, so I'm introducing something new to you today. Either that or you won't admit it. But The Zode is actually taken from a Greek word, which means a way to progress or climb up on something. Did I ever tell you about the young Zode who came to a sign at the fork in the road? He looked one way and the other way too. The Zode had to make up his mind what to do. Well, the Zode scratched his head and his chin and his pants. And he said to himself, I'll be taking a chance. If I go to place one, that place may be hot. So how will I know if I like it or not? On the other hand, though, I feel such a fool if I go to place two and find it's too cool. In that case, I may catch a chill and turn blue. So place one may be best and not place two. Play safe, cried the Zode. I'll play safe. I'm no dunce. I'll simply start off with both places to both places at once. And that's how the Zode, who would not take a chance, went no place at all. Can you finish the line? With a split in his pants. The poor Zode couldn't make up his mind which way to go. How about you? What'll it be today? I want to encourage you on the threshold of this time and this season where we celebrate Thanksgiving to make a choice that will make you really thankful. And it's a choice, understandably, I know some of you have been a Christian for a long time, but it's a choice that we have to commit to every single day as we stand by the well. Because most days in my life, I stand by a well and then also a deep hole that I've dug. Or myself. How many of you have dug yourself some pretty deep holes once in a while, okay? Have you been there? I just wanted to make sure that we're connecting on this level. I find myself oftentimes waking up in the morning and deciding, do I drink from the well or from the cistern? And that really encompasses a lot of Jeremiah's message this morning as I take you to it. And I want to read to you from Jeremiah, the sixth chapter. It's probably one of the most popular scriptures to read from Jeremiah, even though it's really tough to read through this Jeremiah passage of scripture. In fact, it's tough to do a study on it in your life. And I want to tell you, I got a friend who is serving some time in prison right now, and he is studying through the book of Jeremiah and Lamentations, and I'm so impressed that at that moment, at that crossroads in his life, that these are the books that he's choosing to pour into his life. It's important. Not easy. Not easy, but important. So let me read to you, starting with verse 7 from Jeremiah 6. And it says this, "As a well pours out its water, so she," talking about Israel, talking about God's people, his chosen people. It says, "As a well pours out its water, so she pours out her wickedness. Violence and destruction, violence and destruction resound in her. Her sickness and her wounds are ever before me. Take warning, Jerusalem, or I will turn away from you and make your land desolate so no one can live in it. This is what the Lord Almighty says. Let them glean the remnant of Israel." There's a lot of hope in that phrase. Even though this is pretty harsh words, there's a lot of hope in that. "Let them glean the remnant of Israel as thoroughly as a vine." Makes us think about what the vine represents in Scripture, doesn't it? "Pass your hand over the branches again like one gathering grapes. To whom can I speak and give warning? Who will listen to me? Their ears are closed, they cannot hear. The word of the Lord is offensive to them." I hope that's not your heart this morning. "They find no pleasure in it." Jeremiah says, "But I am full of the wrath of the Lord and I can't hold it in." And this gets scary. "Pour it out on the children in the street, on the young man gathered together. Both husband and wife will be caught in it, and the old and those weighed down with years. Their houses will be turned over to others, together with their fields and their wives." This is the warning that Jeremiah gives. "When I stretch out my hand against those who live in the land, declares the Lord, from the least to the greatest, all are greedy for gain. Prophets and priests alike all practice deceit. They dress the wound of my people as though it were not serious. Peace, peace, they say, when there is no peace. Are they ashamed of their detestable conduct?" No, they have no shame at all. "They don't even know how to blush. So they will fall," here's the warning, "so they will fall among the fallen. They will be brought down when I punish them, says the Lord." This is what the Lord says. Hear God's word this morning. This is what the Lord says. "Stand at the crossroads and look. Ask for the ancient paths. Ask where the good way is and walk in it. And you will find" what? "Rest for your souls." Rest for your souls. But this is a sad moment of Scripture. This is why Jeremiah weeps. "But you said we will not walk in it." What do you have? Let's pray for just a moment. Father, we stand before you today and we pray that we're not a people just with very simply ripped pants, but we pray that we're a people with repentant hearts that day by day choose to turn back to you. Sorry for the roads we've traveled and that have left us empty and shallow graves. Father, thankful for the mercy and the grace, for the hope that comes from knowing you. Lord, today as we pause, help us to recognize the importance of a decision. Father, help us to recognize the importance of making a decision to truly take you in, to make you our sustenance, to make you our life. Father, help us to wade through all the stuff in this world and request the good, recognizing that only you are good. And help us daily to walk in you, not just after you or alongside of you, but help us to walk in you. Father, we thank you for calling to us today, for warning us today, We're thankful that you are a God who calls us to repentance, to return. Father, we're thanking you that you are a God who runs to us like a prodigal child when we choose to return to you. Father, we choose that this day. Father, help us to hear your words and not close our ears, in Jesus' name, amen. So have you ever had trouble making a decision? Have you ever had a tough time making a decision? I think that's one of the things that probably we wrestle most with in our marriage is when there's a decision to be made in Lisa and I's life. I don't know about you, if you're a good decision maker or if you are one who really struggles with the big decisions in life. But this is probably the biggest. I want to remind you very simply, your choice in what you will do with Jesus Christ is the single biggest decision you will make in life. Not only here, but in eternity. Your choice of what you will do with Jesus Christ is the single biggest choice that you will make. And if you've had trouble, I want to remind you in the Bible that God is constantly recognizing that, so he's constantly telling his people down through history to make a decision. In Joshua, the 24th chapter, the 15th verse, it says, "But if serving the Lord seems undesirable to you," isn't this interesting? If serving the Lord seems undesirable to you, have there been days where you have walked up to that line and said, "Man, today it is almost undesirable to serve the Lord"? I know that's a scary thing to say. God can handle hearing that from you, okay? God can handle it. Some days, if you've walked up to this line and Joshua walks up this line, says to the people of Israel, "If serving the Lord seems undesirable to you, choose for yourselves this day whom you will serve, whether the gods of your ancestors who served beyond the Euphrates or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you are living." And Joshua has the audacity to stand up and says, "But as for me and my household," how many of you got this little phrase hanging in your house somewhere? "As for me and my household, we will serve the Lord perfectly." Why do we leave that phrase out, right? There's a reason. We will serve the Lord, and he'll make up the difference. I want you to hear that. Then in 1 Kings, in the book of 1 Kings, we kind of marched beyond this, but 1 Kings 18:21, Elijah goes before the people. Remember, this is around the time of the prophets of the whole encounter with the prophets of Baal and the altar that was built and the water that was poured on it, and God consumed it all. Elijah went before the people and said, "How long will you waver between two opinions?" And then he says something really, really interesting. "If the Lord is God," how many of you have been playing with that for a long time in life and found that it's very unsatisfactory? "If the Lord is God," Elijah wasn't really using an if statement. He was emphasizing the fact that we tend to waver in life. "The Lord is God, follow him. But if you think Baal is God, follow him." One more, let me give you another one. In Matthew, the 7th chapter, let's take this into the New Testament. And let's take this into Jesus' teaching. And Jesus says, "Enter through the narrow gate, for wide is the gate, and broad is the road that leads to" what? "Destruction. Many enter through it. Small is the gate, and narrow is the road that leads to" what? Okay, so let's take this seriously for just a moment. What are your choices today? Destruction or life? What'll it be? Only few find it. You see, Jeremiah is dealing with something that's weighty here. It's not something that can wait, but it is something that is very heavy. The subject on Jeremiah's heart is very, 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 very heavy. He says, "Decide whom you will serve." If you have your Bibles, turn back to me, with me to Jeremiah the second chapter, and I want to put this in context of where this is coming from, because this puts it into really simple form, and then the rest of it you can just kind of walk cruise control through, all right? In Jeremiah, the second chapter, Jeremiah is making a case of how sometimes we tend to waver and twist. Say, I want to follow God, but I want to do my own thing. And so he comes to a point in his preaching where he says very poignantly to his people that you got to make a decision between two things. And God speaks through Jeremiah, and he says this, and he says this to our hearts today. So listen with your hearts, and don't feel so much the pressure on your toes that are being squashed right now. God says, my people have committed two sins. Check this out. Number one, they have forsaken me. Wow. Excuse me? 13? Jeremiah 2:13. My people have committed two sins. First of all, it says they have forsaken me. Remember when Jesus was on the cross and he cried out to his Father? He says, my God, why have you what? Forsaken me. Why did God turn his face away from Jesus on the cross? Only one reason. Because he was bearing the entire weight of the sin of the world upon him at that moment. And God cannot bear to look on sin. Isn't it interesting that the reverse can be true for us? That we're so enamored, we're so wrapped up in image and in life, in what it has to offer, that we turn our face away from the living God? Is that crazy or what? God says, my people have committed two sins. They've forsaken me, the spring of living water. Isn't that interesting? And they have dug their own cisterns. What does he say about their cisterns that we dig? They're broken. You ever been broken in life? You ever been down in the bottom of the cistern, and you're still digging deeper, and it's just a broken cistern that won't hold any water? You've dug your own cisterns that cannot hold water. Wow. And so this is the place that Jeremiah is coming from, and he says to us, listen, I want you to understand two things. I want you to understand today, before it's too late, that you need to recognize the importance of a wholehearted decision to follow God. And believe me, I'll be the first one to tell you that there have been times in my life that I have made decisions to follow God, and I have walked it back. Okay? There have been times in my life where I have really struggled to live fully committed to who Jesus Christ is. And then it gets a little bit tough. And you slide a little bit, right? And we're all in this kind of this struggle in life of working out, working out our salvation with fear and trembling. But that's not exactly totally what Jeremiah is talking about here. Jeremiah is talking about getting serious about the decisions that you do make to follow Jesus Christ. And recognizing the importance of that decision. It's not one that you can take lightly. And so God says, through Jeremiah, he says, stand at the crossroads and look. God says today, and I want you to hear this before Thanksgiving, before you can truly pour out your heart thankfully, I want you to hear this. God says you are at a crossroad and you've got to make a decision. I really feel that this is one of those times in history where this must be preached. You can't take both roads anymore. It leaves you split. It leaves you torn. It leaves you exposed. And Satan will take advantage of any exposure. Now, sometimes it won't be that hard to know which path is the right one. And God says the more time you spend in his word, the more time you spend connected to his people, the more time you spend serving and loving as the church and around other people that you belong to. That's why the Bible says don't be unequally yoked with Christians. It doesn't say don't have non-Christian friends, but make sure that you're the one doing the influencing. Make sure that you're the one being the influencer and not the world dragging you a little bit the other way just to fit in. Make sure you're walking God's path without reservation, without looking back. You see, the more obvious God's word is in your life, the more obvious it is that you're on the right path. The problem doesn't really lie in knowing which road is the right one. The problem lies in facing the possibility that it isn't going to be a fun trip. Hey, listen, the world wants to offer you an easy, easy answer, but there's not one. The world wants to present everything and package everything in terms of fun and entertainment, and if you don't participate, guess what? You're missing out. But the reality is totally opposite. If you decide to follow Jesus Christ unreservedly, you're going to risk being persecuted and rejected. Not only by the world outside, but sometimes by people inside the church that want things just to be comfortable. Jesus knew this, so he told us in Matthew the 6th chapter, the 24th verse. Matthew 6:24, if you have your Bibles, you can turn there. I think we have that scripture up as well. But it says this, Jesus said, no one can serve two masters. Serious stuff. Either you will hate the one and love the other, or you'll be devoted to one and despise the other. And then Jesus puts it into the context that hurts us all. You can't serve both God and money. And then in Luke the 6th chapter, he further fleshes this out. He says, blessed are you. And that word blessed is an interesting word because it really means you'll be happy if. Blessed are you when people hate you. That doesn't sound cool. And when they exclude you and insult you and reject your name as evil because the Son of Man, rejoice in that day and leap for joy because great is your reward where? In heaven. How many of you at this point in your life are determined to live for heaven instead of putting up with the hell that's going on around us? What'll it be? That's how people like Jeremiah made it through. They kept their focus on who God was. And yes, they weep their way through the world because the world is broken and lost. And you can chase after it all you want. And you can gain some worldly things, but it will ultimately leave you empty if Jesus Christ is not first. There's a lot of things that this world has to offer that are good because they're given by God, right? If you enjoy them in that context, things become really good. But oftentimes in life, we forget to request what is good. Jeremiah says, ask where the good way is and then walk in it. You see, it's not simply good enough to say, I want to walk with Jesus. I have to make the decision to decide to start the walk. You see, I can talk the talk all day, but until I walk the walk, I'm not going anywhere. I love the t-shirt says, you can walk the walk or talk the talk, but your talk talks louder than your walk talks. Did you get that? Write that down. That makes a great t-shirt. Okay, I'll tell it to you later, Randy. We'll paint it on the side of your tractor. We need to learn that it's literally a crossroad that we're standing at. It's literally a crossroad we're standing at. Jesus died on the cross for your sin, and then he laid it down. You know why Jesus laid down that cross? So you could pick it up. So you could pick it up. You see, I want you to understand this about the life of Jesus. And we're having a Bible study on Sunday nights in my house. And I know we have under 16 people there, whatever the number is, I think most times. But we're walking through a movie series, a TV series called The Chosen. And it's really interesting what you see in that series. You see, the throngs flocked to Jesus because he fed them. Throngs of people wanted to see the signs and miracles and wonders. But if you read in Scripture, when Jesus would not just give them what they wanted to see or to hear, many of them walked away. What's your faith life built on? See, Jesus could have kept the crowds coming if he would have given them excitement, entertainment all the time, and intrigue, but instead, he speaks to us and he says, take up your cross and follow me. Matthew 16:24. It says, then Jesus said to his disciples, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves. Whoa. Did you catch that? What Jesus is saying is an Abraham and Isaac moment. Take what you value the most. Take that little baby waving its arms at me. Take it up there on the mountain and kill it. Seems interesting with that little thing because it's just a play toy, right? You look good with that baby, by the way. Scary, isn't it? Scary, isn't it? But Jesus says, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves. That means I become a living sacrifice. And Jesus says, take up your cross and follow me. And guess what happened to crowds of people that were around Jesus? They're like, whoa. That's intense. I'm out. When it came down to heal me, touch me, make me feel good, that's the Jesus they wanted. But when it came down to sacrifice and service and real love and self-denial, many people walked away. What'll it be? In Matthew 11:28, Jesus goes on and says this, come to me. Because he sees the people walking away, and guess what? It breaks Jesus' heart. Jesus stands at the hill looking down over Jerusalem, and he weeps over Jerusalem, and he sees the condition of his people, and he weeps. He says, if they just come to me, all who are weary and burdened. You ever been there in life, weary and burdened? And Jesus says, come to me, I'm the spring of life. Stop going to that old cistern that you keep digging, trying to find water. It's busted. There's nothing there. And Jesus says, I will give you rest. Rest for your soul. It's amazing what God will give if you'll take him at his word. I have a well at my house. Anybody else still here have wells around? You have a well that works down on the farm. Some of you guys that are farmers still have a well. Do you know how I know my well is good? You know how to test and know that a well is good? Yeah, when water comes out. And not only then, but this guy that dug my well down at the cabin told me why I had a good well. He said, we pumped and pumped and pumped on that well. We pumped and pumped and pumped on that well, and every time we pumped water out, it filled back to the level where it was supposed to be at. God says he is a spring of living water. How many of you are tired in this season of COVID of not really living? Anybody out there? Jesus says, come to me. All you who are thirsty, and I'll give you to drink from the well, the spring of life, and you'll never thirst again. And Jesus offers and offers and offers and offers on a daily basis, even in my life. Every morning I get up and I stand by a well and a deep hole. And you know what? The level of water is always there. And you know what? Most of the time it's overflowing. And the choice is mine. What'll it be? What'll it be? Randy reminded us of a very important verse that says what God's will is in our life. A life that's filled with thanksgiving because we're drinking from the right well. The well that'll never run dry. And today, I just want to remind you at this time in life, as you look around, and there could be a lot of alarms going off in your world and in your life right now. There could be a lot of fears that are enveloping and things that are discouraging. But I want you to remember day by day to choose what you drink from. Drink from the well of living water. Today, we're going to sing a song, and this is a neat song. It says, "Oh, come to the altar." And the significance is this. The altar is a place of self-sacrifice, and we talked about that just a minute. But if you're truly in recognition of who you are, that you're broken and you're overwhelmed by what this world wants to do to you and throw at you, doesn't it make sense to sacrifice that for the life that Jesus gives? And so today, we just invite you to come to the altar. Won't you stand and sing with us today? Sing this song. It's an invitation for all of us today to come to the altar of God and simply choose Him. Won't you do that?
Cutting and broken within, overwhelmed by the weight of your sin, Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar, the Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar, the Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness
Let's pray. So, Father, you've brought us to the altar, and Lord, I just pray before we leave this place, we'll make a decision on what it'll be. Father, once again, we thank you. You're everything we need and so much more. You offer us everything, and we've got nothing to offer in return except our lives. And so, Lord, I just pray that we accept the challenge to lay them down, take up the cross, and walk in you daily, clothing ourselves with the author and perfecter of our faith, Jesus Christ. Thank you for being our Savior, our Lord. Help us to trust you, Lord, and walk in faith. In Jesus' name. All the people said, hey, are you thankful? Tell somebody about it this week. The world needs to know you're thankful, all right? Tell somebody about it.
Thank you.